You might not know his name, but you certainly have heard his drums. He's the rhythm power in films like Matrix Reloaded, Argo, Dragonfly, and many more. Today, he is my guest. Meet the rhythmatist, Greg Ellis.
Welcome to The Power of Rhythm, a podcast with your host, Reinhard Flatischler, around the one thing that connects us all. Rhythm.
Hi, Greg.
Hello, Reinhard. Nice to see you.
So good to have you here. Yeah, rhythm is certainly that connects the two of us as well.
Oh, it sure is. Yeah, we've in our previous discussions, we've made those connections that it's all through rhythm. And here we are finally connecting like this. It's wonderful to be here.
So again, this incredible range of possibilities. You are a drummer, you're a composer, you are a therapist, and you are a philosopher in a way that, making sense out of what can rhythm do for people. You started as a rock drummer, right?
Yeah,
and right. I would be very curious, what led you to India and how did the Indian experience of drums change your drumming and eventually your life?
So yeah, I moved to Los Angeles in 1984. I had just turned 20 years old. And I came down here to go to Musicians Institute, Percussion Institute of Technology, PIT, had just opened up for a couple years. So it was the original staff with Joe Picaro leading it, and Steve Houghton and Efren Toro, and Jeff Picaro would come in and do clinics and stuff. And it was just really a wonderful place to land in. It was a really nice hub. And at that time, networking was everything in Los Angeles. There was no internet or anything. So you really had to get to know people. So that really helped in kind of introducing me to the scene here. And within a couple years of being here, I got my first major label tour with a band called David and David, a songwriting duo that really didn't get their due. They had only did one album, but we toured. It was my first time touring the world at 22 years old. And my eyes just opened up. It was such an experience traveling then as well, when you were really away. You weren't connected all the time like you are now. And the world just started seeping into me during these travels and touring for the next 8 years. That's all I did was rock drumming. And I was on tour with one of my bands in, I believe, late 80s. And just finished a big show in outside of Phoenix, Arizona. And I'm on the tour bus. And the guitar player tossed me a book that his sister had just sent him called Drumming at the Edge of Magic by Mickey Hart. He tossed it to me because he said that she must have meant this for you, because he was a guitar player. I started reading that night, and the next nights on the tour bus reading this book, it was just an epiphanous moment. I had not realized the responsibility and the power of rhythm throughout our evolution. And Mickey tells his story, but also talks about drummers from around the world. And that's when I read about Zakir Hussain and Indian music. And so here I am at 28 years old, thinking I'm set on this trajectory of rock and roll, but my world blew apart. And I started buying the CDs that Mickey recommended in the book and got consumed by Indian music. It really just became, it was a sense of order and being in the moment at the same time. You could hear the melody and the kind of communication in it that I just wasn't getting in rock and roll. So that's really when it opened my ears that there's another world out there. And the next part of the story, after, well, I'll give you do a little break, but it's then the shift from drum set to percussion was really the next kind of big phase of my life.
So when did you first go to India? Where in India? And what did you study first? Did you study a specific drum or?
Yeah, so after, as I said, I just got consumed with this. The band took a break that I was playing in, and I bought a little four-track cassette recorder. And I had collected some drums after reading Mickey's book for a few months or so. I then went to see Zakir Hussain in concert, and I went to see Kodo in concert, and I started really immersing myself in this world of world rhythm. And So my first trip to India, I had started a group called Voss. I had made the shift to percussion, and we had gone to India to get instruments, and it was my first time there, and I spent about 6 weeks. I started actually in Nepal, and then we worked our way down into India. But I didn't go as a student of music. I was really developing my own style. So I never had I never studied Indian percussion per se, except for Nagada in Pushkar. And when I got to Pushkar, I met Natula Solanki, the master Nagada player, and he spent days with me and let me do my style. I could play conventional grip like drum set, even though with Nagada you play the stick this way. And he just gave me permission to kind of find my own way in it. And we bonded and became dear friends, have worked together over the years. But that's what really then I could play an Indian instrument, but I didn't have to go do another lifetime of learning tabla or learning this other language that I just would have been an amateur at for a long time. So,
how has the Indian experience changed your drumming? Has it changed your drumming?
It was a point of singularity for me. It didn't change my drumming. It created my drumming. Because I wasn't a student and I wasn't there to kind of learn that language, I immersed myself in the music. And when I would play with musicians there, the first one being Bikram Ghosh, the tabla maestro from Calcutta, son of Pandit Shankar Ghosh, what they liked is I wasn't there to show them what a good student I've been. I could communicate with them in a dialect they understood, but it wasn't theirs, and it was really about the groove. So I took my drum set sensibility, and I just started putting it to percussion. With Nagada, if it's the low drum, that's my kick drum. The small drum is my snare drum. On Doombeck, on Cajon, I still think kick and snare. So everything is coming from the place of the groove in my head. So I could find the groove in these rhythms that I wasn't doing the same thing or answering in the way that they were used to. And it brought out a different essence in the music. And when I started actually working with Mickey Hart 10 years after I read his book, it was producing a CD called for Kodo, and Zakir was there. And that's where I met Zakir and had developed this style of mine. And we became dear friends because of that as well. All these masters care about is the one. If you respect the one and you find your place in there, you're in. That's all that ultimately matters. And my groove and my time is really good. And I could really keep up and understand what they were doing. And they just loved it. But it wasn't a novelty of look at the good Western Indian drummer, you know?
I understand that fully. Yeah. So you had already, in the very beginning, made an integration. You just brought the playing into your drum set, more or less. You know, that's great. Yeah. But you have studied drum and practiced drums for so many years, as we right. all have as drummers. And here we come to your very, very amazing documentary, The Click, where you describe how today you can just press, you know, a button and it makes a sound because you have sampled it, or you can even press a button and it just plays a sequence because the sequencer does it. And of course, with that, what we lose is the uniqueness, or is even the truth of, you know, I create rhythm. I just press a button in reality. So let's go deeper into that also.
Yeah, it's a deep rabbit hole to go into when you really start thinking about it. I think we've become so desensitized to it over the last 30 years that it's to talk about it, it's almost like archaic in a way of this is what it is, so what's the issue? We must make an alliance. But I think what it lost is, yes, the magic of a musician, but it's just a human breathing through a track. Just that experience of that time in a recording is something that I think is where the transmission of the energy comes through. It's not the chord progression or the lyrics and all that. These are the intellectual kind of connectivities, but the thing that connects a visceral connection to the emotion of music is that resonance of a musician playing their instrument from here to there, and not from here to here and here to here and here to here. That's alternating current. That's gonna keep, like, you know, distracting the signal. I'm talking about direct current energy, and that comes through a musician breathing through the song. And that's what I feel is really, it's that resonance. There was, you know, back in before any of technology doing music, there was just as much bad music as there is now. It's not a judgment of the music. But what you had was a real experience of time that was generated by the energy of the music.
Yeah, and here we come to something I really get in your music. I had an image today when I was listening to the click, which we will be briefly right also, but your music, Kalarupa, for example. This is, and we'll hear that now, it's really fluctuating. You can feel the fluctuation that comes from you playing live. And that is, I had the image all of a sudden, if you have a plaster on, because you broke your arm or so, yes, it's secure and it, you know, holds everything together, but inside it gets weaker and weaker and weaker. So if you have this grit outside or this click outside, you know, it avoids you of getting to the core of feeling that, you know, groove is never something rigid, it's always fluctuating. And if you have something around, you cannot fluctuate, you cannot be flexible. So
that's a fantastic analogy, Reinhard. I've covered every way to look at it as there is, but that's wonderful, because what you're saying is that it's not this external thing that we're following, that it's encompassing us. So inside, you still have the live material, but it's contained by this, and you're absolutely right. The muscle atrophies, the muscle weakens, and that's the soul of the music. I love that analogy. That's really, really well put.
Great. And I think our listeners are really now curious on the music we're talking, Kalarupa. Now, Kala means time, you know, Mahakala, the big time, the timelessness. Rupa means?
Rupa means form, like something that which has form. So the analogy that I had that was taking two words literally as a phrase, it actually has different meanings in India, but the two words being time, form, what I was saying is rhythm is basically giving form to time.
Is it improvised? Is it composed? Is it both?
I composed, yeah, the bass tracks were composed. I would just pretty much lay down a groove and then decide the levels going on over it. Sometimes I would just leave a track going. If I heard something that really made like melodic sense, I'd work it out and record it again. But for the most part, everything is live take top to bottom of all the layers that I played.
Ready to listen. la Rupa, Greg Ellis. How groovy that is. You know, when I grew up with the percussion, it was the 60s. In the 60s, we were like rebels. We were proud to be rebels and do something that, you know, the normal people will say, what crazy stuff is that? We were proud of that, you know, to be different, you know, outstanding in a way. Today, you can actually find, as the music styles narrow down more and more, you know, with all the electronics, and also the people, especially in the corona time now, everyone try to just look around, oh, what is the other one saying? Can I say this? Or, you know, will I be looked at crazy? So I think it's related to that click that you say that we have been educated in becoming much more in a conformity.
Right. I think of that often, where if I was 20 years old today, moving to Los Angeles, there's no way the journey would have happened. The journey happened for me discovering these instruments and my true, not just, I think, you know, in terms of mastery or whatever that, of artistry, I'll say. Prior to that, as a rock and roll drummer, I loved playing, and I still love playing kit, but I didn't have the technical level that I could just kind of show off and do it. I played great in a song. But the journey from that to getting into a level of composition and artistry and technical mastery with the percussion that I've done, it took probably 15 years of making that decision at 28 years old to where I could really step up and kind of play with the masters in that way. That journey is what got me there. It wasn't just the years of practice and understanding. It was the time and the way, how to even get to India. How can I take 6 weeks off from my life and keep it going? Those decisions that I couldn't just download a lesson with somebody in India or anything. So you had to show up. And I think that time of the process it takes to either create something or to have a life's journey, when that's removed or when that's done through an app kind of guiding you, you know, there's nothing dangerous there, right? It's you won't find anything out about you in a way that the journey takes you on, and you're confronted with situations. I mean, I remember where, you know, you couldn't find a phone line. You go 3 or 4 days with no contact, trying to find an STD booth that you could, you know, at that time in India. You had to dig deep to yourself, and learning a music and being involved in a culture that was so foreign to me, I had to just completely be vulnerable and open myself up. And that could only happen over time. That's a gradual process. So that's where I think we've lost again. Like you say, as everything gets more similar and similar, I'm thinking of all the musicians that would have my kind of our take of growing up in the West and making that journey, who will never experience it because it's not needed anymore.
I have the impression we are very, very narrow to a big, big change. I see people waking up in incredible amounts and being ready for courage, for living the life, for remembering that, you know, it's not just the going through the life secure, but daring things and do crazy things, you know. Yeah. And I'm very humbled and very thankful that we can actually play a part of your click, you know, so people understand what did you bring there. Okay, so let's listen to the click.
Though you may not know my name, I'm sure you've heard my drumming. If you've seen the movies 300, Argo, The Matrix Reloaded and Revolutions, Iron Man, Transformers, Watchmen, Body of Lies, and over 100 more, you've heard my drumming. I performed around the world in front of millions of people with artists of all genres and dozens of countries. I've seen the world from behind my drums and communicate with it through its language of rhythm. But that language is being silenced. Now what you hear isn't the language of the drum. The drums and the drummer have been replaced through digital means. The language of the drum is now frozen in a world of programs and loops. Our digital sense of time is fully embraces real time. After hundreds of years of the clock, to the onslaught of automation, to the assembly line, from the metronome, to the sequencer, to the click track, to the drum machine, and now AI and robotics. The drummer becomes a metaphor for the worker who is now the one being replaced by a robot. Our natural sense of time and rhythm has been claimed by a mechanical form for centuries, and I wanted to know why. Why was there such a fear of the drum and our natural sense of time? What I found out was more fascinating and in many ways scarier than I ever could have imagined. I began my journey as a professional drummer in 1986 at the onset of the digital revolution, and as we're now more than 30 years in from those early days of programmed rhythm, the synthetic beats have ushered in a devotion to mechanical time that has infiltrated all aspects of our lives. And in witnessing the shift of analog to digital from inside the studio and on the stage, I watched the audience learn to dance to a machine. As I've experienced countless times, a culture reflects, communes, and engages itself through its language of rhythm. But as our drums became digitized, our culture and social network became digitized as well. We are all on the click.
From Greg Ellis. Now, I want to actually substitute, I think we're moving out of the click soon. I feel so many people yearning for essence of life, for essence of being alive, and with this you will naturally come to rhythm, because rhythm is the essence, you know, that behind every living organism. So I think the time for rhythm is just about to come.
I agree. You know, I think there is, it's for many years I was really thinking it's one or the other, that it's organic music against mechanical music, or like digital versus analog. The digital, the click is here to stay. It's not going anywhere. Our atomic clocks are now down to 1/1,000,000,000th of a second, you know, off every billion years or something, but it's still off. They can't get it perfect. So the idea of the clock and a click track, that's there. So what we're looking at is, we don't have any other way. If I record a set of organic music CDs, like RhythmPharm, for instance, the only way to get them to you is still through a digital platform. You see, so that's here to stay. So what we've got to find is we have to seek out this natural time. We have to seek out these experiences and allow these experiences to be as accessible as the onslaught of everything else that we're fed on the machine.
I don't think there's anything wrong with digital and all these things. The only wrong thing is that we lost our connection to rhythm, that we allowed ourselves to be pulled away. Just, you know, with splitting an atom, we could have done different things, but what we created is a nuclear bomb, you know. It's kind of the being mature enough to use things that you develop, and technique is quite a very powerful thing. So I don't think it's bad per se. No, not at all. But when we go back to these natural rhythms, and this is coming soon, I think even in this year we'll have huge changes. I feel this in my gut. I have no other things, but I feel it in my gut. So that brings me also to this thing that you have been in so many films. Yes, I could ask you, how did you go there? But much more interesting for me, how do you approach that? Is there the movie first? Is there the script? Is there the composed music? Is there the drum first? What's first there? And how do you go about? What's the blueprint?
It changes a lot. It really depends on the project. It depends more on the level and the budget of the project over anything else. The limitations come very quickly when there's not a big budget in terms of the time a composer can hire live musicians or the studios they can record at. Most of it's done at, obviously all this year, it's been done at home. But even for years, I've been doing most of my recording remotely here at home. If we do some taikos or timpani, or, you know, we need the big layers, then I will go to a big studio, a proper studio. But for all my hand drums, it's a good mic into a good preamp into Pro Tools, and that's anywhere you would do that. You don't need a room necessarily. So I've learned to record myself really well like that. So actually all the music you hear in the click trailer is all stuff from my film work, and most of what you heard on that stuff was recorded at my house here. So it does vary. What happened, I started this group Voss I mentioned earlier, and I learned to layer my percussion in very kind of melodic and cinematic ways, where I wasn't doing an ensemble like an Indian ensemble or a Latin American ensemble, where each person is playing the role of that one rhythm. So each person has their part. What I was doing is layering on, even on the Calarupa piece, I'm layering gargarbas from Mexico, from Morocco, with chanchans from Indonesia, with the nagadas, with the dolak, with cajon. So I found ways to blend these instruments without being kind of geographically specific. So it allowed, instead of just playing tabla over a track or traditional darbuka over a track, composers responded to me layering my instruments in ways that kind of created this a symphony of percussion in a sense. So it really matched well with the orchestra. It could be action, it could work with electronics, and it just became a way of layering. So it would generally start with laying down a shaker, gargarba or chan-chan that I would kind of get a timekeeper going. And then you listen for either accents in the score. The score comes first. Rarely do I see picture unless I'm in the studio for property reasons. They can't send me a picture when I'm working at home. But even if there's a picture, that's more for the composer to watch. I'm reading the music, or I'm really focused on my part. The part's worked out. We rarely improvise in a sense of, you know, a layered part. There may be some improvisational takes where you do bowed metals and waterphone and gongs and things, ambient stuff, but all the rhythmic stuff is already tight to the picture. So and then you just start layering and finding creative ways to mute and bring things in and out, and it just became a style I did that really in the early 2000s, the style of music with Matrix, films like Matrix and Iron Man, it was just starting to blend electronic, but there was still this live component in there. It wasn't completely taken over by CGI, so there's still a human component that transmitted through the music as well. So that's kind of how I approach it, pretty much. But some of it's completely written out, some of it I do come up with my own parts, but the ins and outs of where to go when I'm hired by someone, it's pretty clear that's set before I go in.
What is Voss? You mentioned this name. What is Voss?
Voss is a group that I started in the late 1997. It was myself and an Iranian singer named Azam Ali. And it was started as just percussion and voice. She actually sang. She was from Iran but grew up in India. She sang in a language of her own kind of design, like a Dead Can Dance style. And I just did the organic percussion underneath, and we got a deal with Narada Records in 97, and released about four albums as a group, and then Calarupa, and then her solo album was released during that time as well. So we did about six albums over 7 years. We were busy and touring a lot, and that's what got me connected to Mickey Hart, was he heard the group Voss. So it was just a world music duo, but everything, that's where I really learned to produce and compose and really layer my percussion in ways that that developed the film approach that I do as well.
Do you remember what was your first big film?
Oh, wow, the first big one.
Something I would recognize.
Well, I mean, what it came early on was the Matrix Reloaded.
Oh,
so,
right.
Wow. Yeah, I worked with a composer named Tyler Bates, who did 300 and Watchmen and Guardians of the Galaxy, and he's prolific out there. But I did a lot of his early films, and so nothing that stood the test of time. But they were, you know, big films at the time. But when I got the call for The Matrix, that was the one that really, because I loved the first Matrix. I just, it's funny now, you look back and so much of it's cliche and been done and we've seen it so much. But you remember when that movie came out, it affected me. Yeah. And it, not so much thinking of what the movie was, but got me thinking of these ideas on my own and seeing it in right in front of me. So working on that was interesting. It was with a composer from an artist in England who has a group called Juno Reactor that I've worked with for years as well. And it blends kind of psytrance techno with organic rhythms and vocals and really cool stuff. He's from Brighton. So he was hired to do all the techno cues for the second, for Reloaded and Revolutions. And they were recorded back to back. So we worked for almost 8 months on both scores. So there's a human, on all the techno cues, there's a human thing in there. I at least would do a hi-hat or a shaker. But I said, like, I was Neo of the score. Like, I was the one human in this Matrix world that was, like, still giving it some kind of life. And that was never discussed beforehand. But I think energetically these things do come through in a way, as subtle as they are. But there is a Tibetan bowl in there. There is my Gargarvas and my Nagatas, and they're in there. So they're part of the Matrix. But that was exciting. That's when I knew. And then 300 and of course, was another really big milestone one. And then Iron Man. But it's much more romantic than it sounds. These sometimes are just really like sessions that it's a deadline. I work for 2 days. I forget everything, send it off, and they mix it in and do it all. But certain scores like Argo was really beautiful. We had 3 days at Capitol Records to record just percussion. And the composer, Alexander Desplat, is just one of my favorites and meticulous composer and an incredibly creative producer. And that was a real treat. That was really a musical experience, which is it not always is. It's an office experience a lot of times. But
but it's amazing that you have been the one human composer, a component in the Matrix, you know, that again is really the sign of Greg Ellis for me.
I'm not going to let go, man. I made it this far. There's no way my heartbeat's not going to continue to get in these projects. So, and actually, one quick thing now, because video games are now the next level where all these composers are going. So I just have done a big Sony PlayStation game. I've done a few of the God of War franchise games, but I just did another big one that I can't say anything about that will be out next year. But again, I'm adding this complete heartbeat kind of vibe to now a complete virtual world. So there's no human in the world at all. But you still have these composers that want the live thing in there. And, you know, God bless them, because it's like it keeps me going. And I think it keeps, like you said, it keeps the hope alive, you know. So
let's listen at least to one of your tracks, The Dragonfly. Can we play it, right?
This is great, yeah.
Dragonfly, Greg Ellis. You know, on the preparation for our podcast here, I checked out a lot of different videos on the net, and there are really plenty of videos from me on the net. And what touched my heart so deep and what really resonated with me, because it's the same approach I feel, you are having these African ankle bells and you're going like crazy with the groove in it, and then you are really burning while you drum. So for me, there's nothing between you, the drum, and the audience. It's just one. And that really touches me, because I think that is, if we talk healing, that is what is healing. It's just here and now. It's timelessness, you know? You're reaching timelessness. So that is what really I think is fascinating about your work.
I appreciate that, you know, and that's been, it's been the hardest year and a half of all our lives, but for my life specifically, not having that connection and not having that ability to be, to challenge myself when I play live, because when I play live, I'm all in. It's right before a concert, it's interesting. I get very, very tired, like 5 minutes, we're off the side of the stage going on, and I just start yawning, and I just like, oh, I just want to take, and I think what I'm doing is I start each performance where I start from emptiness. It's like a balloon I want to fill up. I don't want to come out here all ready to go and then, like, you know, try to keep it like that the whole time. So I really have that sense of this flow. And, you know, when I have that live, the audience is aware of this. And I can really keep my own with anybody, even though technically I'm certainly not at all on a traditional level of probably 90% of the musicians I work with. But what comes through is a different kind of mastery. And that's why I like the referring myself to a rhythmist in that way. My sole responsibility is to the groove. And so I'll push myself technically or with some fast and technical things. I actually like to push myself to the point of what would be perceived as a mistake, because that's where I love fixing the misstep at the speed of light. You know, when you're dealing at 64th notes at like 140 beats a minute, that space in between those two notes, you and I, we know if that finger missed, and I love trying to rectify that and make it seamless and those kinds of challenges. So I push myself, and I think the audience responds to that. I think there's nothing rehearsed. There's nothing gimmicky. I really am getting into the vibe and the sound of what I'm feeling in that moment. And that's going to be recognized by anybody, regardless of what style or genre you're playing.
So what you're saying about the mistake or so, what I found in my work that's called TaKeTiNa, and you're doing one rhythm with the foot, one other with the clap, or one other with the voice. And of course, in this process, everyone loses it. Mm-hmm. And the more you lose it, that's a miracle. The more secure you become when you come back and you lose the fear of making mistakes, you actually start, as you say, to play with mistakes. You know, in Japan, the perfection is when there's imperfection. And if it's perfect, they put something in that makes it imperfect, you know.
Right. In beadwork in Africa, they do this, what's called the spirit bead. And so if there's a field of black beads, there'll be one red bead in there that seems random or a mistake, but it's fully intentional that there is no perfection. So the beauty is that imperfection.
Here I was the healing theme, and what I found very fascinating, you have something created that's called RhythmPharm, like Rhythm Pharmacy. And you know, that's more up to date than ever, because now everyone runs to the pharmacy, try to get a shot or whatever, you know, but the immune system, you know, is what we need to stimulate. So what is the idea behind the RhythmPharm?
It started initially not as an idea of becoming RhythmPharm. This was in early 2005, I believe, late 2004. My work from 2000 to 2004, my film work, but more my session work, my drum set work, had been basically decimated because of the onslaught of the loop libraries at that point. Drum machines were one thing, samples were one thing, but once loop libraries came out, where you could have, you know, Steve Gadd playing a verse groove at five different ways and recorded by Bob Clearmountain at Ocean Way Studios, and you buy that for $1,000, that's, you know, one day in the studio for me. So you now have that. Who can compete with that? Once those loop libraries started getting really sophisticated, and then the nature of the process drum sound really became the standard of pop music, where you stopped hearing, even if you had a live drummer, it would be processed to sound like a machine. Once it ate into the kind of work I did. Like I said, I wasn't this first call session guy, because I played percussion, I toured with other bands. So I wasn't an LA kind of session guy, but I play really well in a song. I'd be hired for albums because they wanted that style throughout an album, not, you know, Keltner here and Bernard Purdy here, like a Steely Dan thing. And so I brought that to it, and that was the work that I did on the album front. And that, within 3 or 4 years, that was gone in the early 2000s. So I was, of course, I was angry, but I was also really like finding what is this component that people are either afraid of or resistant to or just not interested anymore. So I challenged myself for one day a month, every day for a month, to record with just my organic instruments. So no plastic skins, everything made from bone, metal, animal skin, shell, clay.
From all around the world, right?
From all around the world. So these, yeah, all this collection of music I'd been doing. And I had layered myself compositionally with it. I'd been doing my film work. I'm, you know, well into the second phase of my career here. But I recorded these without a click track, without any samples or loops. I would just put up a mic and record one instrument, and without listening, do a next one, and 4 or 5 tracks in, once I started learning the piece, I called it done. I didn't want to compose it. I wanted it to be a discovery. So once I started making compositional choices, that's when I called it finished. I didn't want it to be a composition. So you really feel, when you listen to them, you feel this journey of discovery, because every layer that I do is discovering the previous layer. So I also would not punch myself in any way. So if I have a bell part that only comes in 3 minutes into a piece, I would still press record from the beginning. So I would breathe. I would still be in the recording breathing up until the part I came in. Like you would in a studio. You don't leave the room and come in a bar before you're ready to go. You know, you listen, you get there naturally. So these were all ideas that, you know, some people could listen and think that's kind of a gimmick, but I knew that was being lost in the studio. We would start at the second chorus and punch it in. We didn't play it from the beginning if we just needed to get the second chorus. And you started skipping this vibe, you know? And that real, so in a, let's say a 10-minute piece on a rhythm tonic that I call them, if I have 6 layers, there's actually 60 minutes of real time in that 10-minute dose. Yeah. So it becomes almost like a way you listen to it and it feels like a lot longer than it is to your body, because you do have these layers of, from the beginning to end, I'm alive in the track.
And the ingredients are the drums that you also mentioned very clearly. And then there is your lifetime. I mean, it's your presence. That for me, it's more like not just that you let it run for so long, but if you have only 3 minutes in the middle, you are present throughout the whole thing. Then you play a thing and you're present. And the presence is also something that goes in the medicine, right?
That's right. Exactly right. You don't keep that. You integrate the whole thing. So if there's just a small measurement of something, it's integrated still with the whole thing. So
how many different pharmacies do you have? You're like, you have Serenity. I want to play a little bit of that.
Oh, great.
How many do you have of them?
So there's 7 CDs in the set. This was done in 2005. So this is before streaming or, you know, YouTube started, wasn't even started yet. So it was meant to be a hard copy experience, so it's with the CD. So each CD is, there's 7 of them, and it goes from growth to serenity to vitality, balance, clarity, and then I call the hero's dose is the inner journey, and that's the last one. But I still have the sets that you can email me directly for digital high quality MP3s, but it's not the same, obviously, as the real thing, but it's going to be expanded. I'm going to find a way to do a digital way of the same idea. But anyway, this is all from, yeah, the original CD set.
So let's give the listeners an idea about RhythmPharm, Serenity. Serenity, RhythmPharm from Greg Ellis. All the listeners, I really recommend you check that out. There's so much to discover. You just go to Greg Ellis's website. You find a lot of amazing stuff.
Actually, it's great. If you email me directly at greg@rhythmpharm.com, that's I send them directly now from there, but you can hear on rhythmpharm.com, you can get learn about the idea and hear some samples and things, but it's different when you hear it when you have a good quality file and you're not hearing it on YouTube and that, it's a different thing. But it's a powerful set of music in that way.
But I have to say, just going to your website, there's so much to discover, and it's a very good entrance into the world you represent. Now, in these confusing times, in these crazy times, a word of wisdom for young drummers, Greg Ellis to young drummers, what do you tell them?
I'm actually encouraged by the young drummers I'm seeing. Young drummers, I mean the teenage, the younger ones. I think we've gone through this phase of the last 10 years of the Instagrams and TikToks and this kind of needing to show what you can do that, you know, maybe you'd be years away from playing live without that platform. I think we give it away too quickly, and that can kind of, I think, either give a young student too much kind of ego at a young age and that kind of notoriety. But I'm seeing that a lot of them now that are posting are really back into kind of playing grooves. They're playing along to older songs and stuff. But it's like what you said. I think there's a resurgence of this feeling that's going to come that is not dissimilar, I think, to rock and roll in the 50s after World War II. I think there was this rebellious nature of this kind of provincial way of life, and the war kind of brought reality to the doorstep around the world. And I think that's what COVID has done here. I think there's going to be not an intellectual choice made of, oh, this is what we need now. I think there's going to be this visceral cellular deficiency that we're going to start realizing. And the young musicians are going to have, I think, a very similar rebellious nature. And rebellion now means anti-mainstream platform. So I started thinking this word. I thought, we don't need an internet, we need an anti-net. We need something that to get back to understanding that our connectivity is there regardless of this device. And musicians and playing in the room, young bands that play together. There's one young drummer in India, I don't know if you know of him, named Stephen Samuel.
No.
He's well worth checking out. It would actually be an interesting guest on your show too. I think he's probably 14 or 15 now, maybe 14. I did a performance with him, one of my last ones last year in India, with at a tribute to U Srinivas, the wonderful mandolin player. I play with his brother, U Rajesh. And Stephen was on the gig, and just, he's, you know, one of those kids from India, but he's developed this style, but he was such a giving musician at 13 years old. He didn't step on anybody. He nailed what he did. He was, every part he did was musical and over technique. It wasn't to show off. It was to add to the, he knew how to build it up. Just unbelievable. I thought I would be listening to a drummer of 30 years old, but I think a lot of drummers today aren't remembering that where great drummers are realized and recognized is in the music, not the solo. The solo can be an integral part of a show, but the solo is not where you really see the genius of a Jeff Porcaro or of Steve Gadd or a Bernard Purdy or an Elvin Jones, you know, or a Billy Cobham. I mean, these guys, what they play in the music, what the music needs, that's the advice I give to the young musicians, is play for the music. You're doing such amazing drum parts. Find that guitar player, find that keyboard player that wraps around you in the same way, that creates a sound, that creates a unique, you know, kind of place to hang out in for a while instead of just replicating what's been there. And I think there is hope. I think there is a rebellion in, my daughter's 13 years old. Her generation is not falling for it the same way my 21-year-old daughter did, you know? So I think we're on the right trajectory. I'm with you, Reinhard. I have optimism here, and I think it's up for the elders to really remind us what we're here for as drummers and musicians, and to inspire the young players. But I think it's really the most we can do is continue to offer platforms like this for young musicians to hear what it's really about. And there's plenty of that out there. But that's, I think, probably what I would say.
So, Greg, thank you so much for what you give to my podcast, to the audience that listens to it, words of wisdom. And I'm sure from my heart we will play and reconnect in music sometime soon. You know, I'm doing this orchestral project that you hear here. I'm trying to revive megadrums.
Wonderful.
In some of this we will meet. I really adore your work. I adore what you stand for. And thank you so much on being on my podcast.
It's my pleasure. So, I mean, just after all these years to finally connect, Reinhard, it's really been a pleasure. So I look forward to everything ahead for us.
And so, your listeners, I hope you really enjoyed our discussion, the points we went through. If you like it, go to our website, which is powerofrhythm.com/podcast. You find the transcription. You also find the video there. So check it out and check out Greg Ellis's sources. They are really, really precious. And with that, have a great time and keep on grooving.